thinking of kind of ambition at the start was, I think, to try and prove people wrong, not on a national bit, not on a kind of a national Welsh basis, but we wanted to kind of try and prove that a band could come out from Wales, definitely, because, you know, we were, there were a lot of puns kind of attached. You know, you'd watched a band like The Alarm and stuff who got completely and utterly kind of torn to shreds. And you were just aware of that there was no expectation about music coming out of Wales, rock and roll coming out of Wales. I think, you know, there was a subconscious thing in our heads that we wanted to disprove that. But I think we just wanted to kind of escape the vacuum at first of all, more than anything, didn't we, really? We just wanted to escape the kind of that TV footage of miners' strikes and wholesale closure and just completing that kind of like, you know, well, people just feeling as if that we were not in the middle of anything, really.
Yeah, it's just a bizarre, truly deluded thing with me that I kind of just always felt it was going to, that I just wanted to crush the opposition. I couldn't stomach reading about all these idiots week after week. I still feel the same now. It's the total Gore Vidal thing, you know, it's not enough to succeed, others must fail. I really wanted to put other bands out of business.
None of us could actually believe that bands weren't writing with a political angle whatsoever. No. I mean, that was massive amongst us, all of us, you know. You know, even more so in an intellectual sense between Nick and Richie, but we just couldn't believe that any of these bands, except for McCarthy, let's face it, were a shining light, and that nobody was actually trying to infuse politics into rock and roll.
We did very few gigs in Wales. We were, in all honesty, we were pretty unpopular, you know, in Wales, more than anywhere, especially in Cardiff, where everyone had a saxophone and yellow jeans and, you know, was making absolutely ridiculous music. It really was terrible. And then you had the really kind of great Newport hardcore scene, which was really good, but they obviously didn't like us.
But yeah, we were more clash-esque and they were more kind of like, you know, conflict and crass kind of thing.
We did a gig in TJ's, didn't we?
Yeah, we did a gig in TJ's, supporting a band called Cheetah Chrome Motherfuckers. One of the heaviest.
Were they from Yugoslavia or somewhere like that?
They're from Italy.
Italy, oh, that's right, yeah.
And their album's called Into the Void. One of the heaviest bands I've ever come across. But so we didn't fit.
Brilliant.
We didn't fit in the hardcore scene in Newport. And we didn't fit in with the kind of the sub kind of pseudo kind of art rock school scene in kind of Cardiff. So actually, you know, strangely, you know, when we actually went to London, it felt as if perhaps it was the first time we connected with an audience when we played at the Horse and Groom, which is strange to think.
Because we'd done the beer car before that, didn't we? That pay-to-play gig.
Yeah.
Of which nobody was there.
Yeah. No one was there. We sold all our record collections to do this gig in Bristol beer car. All our brilliant indie records. My Bloody Valentine, all the rest. There was 10 people there. Richie drove us to that gig.
Yeah. The scene in Wales at that point was just really insular and more bitchy than we could have ever wished to be.
Yeah.
You know, so we had to go somewhere else to find.
So it was a last desperate attempt, really, like Horse and Groom. I think that's why we put everything into it.
It was a big deal. Yeah. It's a big deal.
First time I heard about the Manics was Kevin Pierce wrote to me and told me about them. I think he was in correspondence with Richie. And at that point, they'd done Suicide Alley, I think. Kevin must put something on a tape for me, I think about it. I must have had a demo. So I had no idea what they were going to sound like. Because I remember at the time getting them confused with the Hellfire Sermons. They were another group that Kevin really liked. It's not a dissimilar name. But they sounded absolutely nothing like them, obviously. They were clearly political. I mean, like from the slogans on the shirts, just the way they presented themselves. They clearly thought it all out. And I think the fact they were from Wales at that point, there was no other prominent bands from Wales, made them seem exotic, if anything. It was, you know, I suppose it could have been a stick for some people to beat them with, but it made it feel like it was understandable that they were the way they were, because it was seemed quite isolated, I suppose. And also, I'd never heard of Blackwood, and I don't think many people had, which was where they always said they came from.
Awesome Groom was the first time we kind of made an assault on London as a band, kind of thing. Definitely.
We drove up so early that we spent about 2 hours in Regent's Park having sandwiches and sitting on a bench. We were good timekeepers even then.
And it was the only place without parking meters.
That's true. The first gig at the Austin Group was a lot of good. One of those, Kevin Pierce was kind of promoting it. You know, he seemed to know everyone. And obviously Bob Stanley turning up as well. And another tall fella who used to do a fanzine that Richie knew. remember him? Really tall guy. He did the flexi disc, I think, of UK channel Boredom.
Oh, yeah, there's a couple of members of the Jasmine Minx.
Indeed.
In the crowd as well. I was a massive fan of the Jasmine Minx.
When we walked downstairs, I think we thought it was going to be more, we hate you and you hate us, but it just wasn't. It was, everyone was just kind of really surprised that they liked us as well. And we were so embarrassed. I remember Kevin gave us 50 quid and he and Richie gave him 30 quid back.
Yeah.
Even though we had absolutely no money whatsoever, I remember Richie giving him some money back.
I remember thinking it was, it made me laugh out loud while I was watching them. I'm not sure if that's the reaction they were expecting, but it was just like, they were like, you know, so intense and so enthusiastic, but basically just looked like the Clash in 1977, I suppose. It was, which was, nobody was doing anything remotely like that then. But obviously, the tunes were great as well, so it was really exciting.
It did actually feel as if somebody had got us for the first time. They got the idea of us because we all had our spray paint shirts on. I think it was the best we'd ever looked for a concert.
Yeah.
And we all looked really uniform for that concert, and I kind of just felt like, you know, the slightly art pop nature of what we were doing, even though it wasn't, you know, pop. Just, it felt as if people were tuned into it for the first time.
There's a couple of people, like sort of Bob and some of the sort of indie fanzine guys, they thought, are these guys sort of Mega City 4 or Senseless Things, or are they something different? And I think as soon as they saw us, they realised we were a lot different from that.
Barely any of the songs we played in that concert end up on GT, I don't think, do they?
No. I think A Few on Heavenly, Sorrow 16.
Yeah, we played Sorrow 16 there, which ended up in the Ebony Motown Junk single.
We played Suicide Alley. We did New Art Riot.
Yeah.
Which was probably the best. So that's the one song everyone liked a lot.
We did another song called Destroy the Dance Floor, which never got redone anywhere else in any other format.
Which was anti-pill culture.
Yeah.
And we did Anti-Love.
Anti-Love.
It's a brilliant title.
Tennessee.
I don't know if we did Tennessee. Yeah, we must have.
Yeah, we did. Yeah, so Tennessee.
That was on GT.
Played there that night.
Yeah, that's probably the only one.
I think we only played for 30
minutes.
Any
cover versions?
25 minutes. No.
No, Kino.
No, that was TJ's.
That was TJ's.
When we did Gino.
And so
it was a very short set.
Mm. Did we do an encore? No.
Did we do Bank Account Reality?
No.
You sure?
Yeah, I'm sure.
We didn't play more than 30 minutes.
I interviewed him for Melody Maker, and this came around my flat, and we went to the pub, Dartmouth Arms. Richie was just playing on the fruit machine the whole time. I think he might have said a couple of things, just went off and played on the fruit machine. And Nicky was just going, yeah, that's what he does. That's what he does all day long. And then they stayed over. So, like, me and Pete had a pretty big flat, and we had loads of spare mattresses for some reason. So, you know, you could stay in this room. And they didn't want to. They wanted to stay in the van outside the flat. I've no idea why. Camaraderie. I don't know. They put out New Art Riot on a 12-inch, and it was a pretty awful production, and it was one of my favourite songs. And I must have had a cassette of that from Kevin, I guess. And I just said to them, can I stick this out? Have you got the master tape? And they hadn't got the master tape because I think they couldn't afford to buy it, so they wiped over it. So the best thing we had was like a third generation cassette. But I said, yeah, of course, yeah, stick it out by all means. And John Savage was a fan by this point and suggested the Feminine's Beautiful cover, which they loved. And we got it pressed in this place on Stratford High Street, which must be in the Olympic Park now, or on the edge of it. It's like long gone. And the singles were pressed on black cardboard, I think. It's like, it's the worst pressing ever. It's the only time I ever used that pressing plant. So even if it was a third generation cassette, they made it sound much worse, the pressings.
After playing Horse and Groom on Great Portland Street, Bob Stanley reviewed it for the Melody Maker.
Yeah.
And also we had an alternative single of the week from The Enemy, which Stephen Wells had kind of reviewed. So we had a press pack.
That was Suicide Alley.
For Suicide Alley. So we had a press pack. We had a live review from London from Bob Stanley and a single of the week from The Enemy from Stephen Wells. So that played its part in us being able to send something off to, you know, Philip.
Yeah.
Philip Hall kind of thing. It looked, suddenly looked slightly impressive in an indie kind of way.
When I was working with Philip at the PR company and we were doing Stone Roses, Sundays, Pogues, Lars, Beautiful South, I think he wanted to try and find a band that we could manage, but obviously from a PR perspective, finding a band that he'd think he could get good press on. And we got this letter from Richie, but it basically said, we are your future of thin skin, riots, exhaustion, and a photo of the four of them standing with leather jackets on, all smoking cigarettes, looking well hard. So I was like, oh, blimey. So I showed my brother that. He said, this is interesting, give him a call. So I called up Richie's home number. I said, is there Richie Edwards there, please? And his mum, Richard! He said, hello? I said, hi, this is Martin from All the Nothing PR. You know, I've got your letter. Can we find out more about you? So they sent us New York Riot. So we were intrigued and liked the record and decided to go down to South Wales to check him out.
The first time I think Philip and Martin saw us was they saw us in Camden and came to Newbridge School.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then the first time Martin and Philip saw us play was supporting the Family Cat at Tree Forest Polytechnic, I think, was it?
Bristol. Or Tree Forest.
Mr. Forest Park.
Tree Forest. Yeah.
Was that before they came to Newbridge, though? No, that was after.
Newbridge was the first meeting.
So we went in the room, a bit trepidatious, and certainly I was, and they all dressed up in the mum's blouses and the slogans, etc., etc. And before we gone in, Wire had been practicing, and I managed to bang himself in the head with his bass guitar and cut his forehead open. So we walk in, and while I was standing here with blood just streaming down his neck, and I'm thinking, fucking hell, two songs, and we're back out of here, because slightly unusual. James was so shy, he couldn't look us in the face, you know what I mean? And Richie was kind of the friendly, diplomatic one. But they did the set, and it was, you know, rudimentary. They did Repeat, I think Love, Sweet Exile, the original version, and they were, you know, Philip really got it, I didn't get it so much. Then we went for dinner with them at the Place Hotel in Blackwood. I just sat chatting with him, and Philip, after an hour and a half of them with their agenda and their ambition, what they wanted to do, Philip was just hooked and said, look, we're in for this. Because regardless of how good they were musically or not good musically at the time, just on a PR angle, he thought, this is going to be fucking amazing.
One of the very first tactical things I remember Philip talking about was that, you know, Nick and Richie had to meet a lot of journalists. They had to actually had to meet you kind of thing.
Yeah.
They had to, you know, to get the idea across, you know, because we were kind of different. And it was, you know, the Manchester thing was just, you know, starting and all that kind of stuff. I remember him just saying, you know, you've got to try and meet as many journalists as possible, talk to them after gigs and stuff, because they're just going to think you're mental. And that's good.
Yeah, I think it was a relief to the music press to have some people like us just taking our bedroom, our internal chatter from the bedroom where the four of us would just rant on for days and days into an interview situation. I mean, the interviews went on for ever and ever. There's no way they just liked talking to us. You know, it was just, they would last 8 hours at the time, you know, the Stud Brothers or John Wilde and all the stuff like that.
To be really, you know, they're kind of fair about it, most of those early interviews were, me and Maura would tag along and we would fuck off at some point, and these two would just be talking, and like the journalists would be just like, we don't need you two, we're just going to focus on these two, that as you know, and it was a good time for us, wasn't it?
It's really good. It still is.
That
hasn't changed in 20 years.
I think for every person that got it, there's about three people who didn't when I started. It's people just couldn't see how they weren't just sort of punk rehash. On top of which, the band they referenced most at that point were Birdland, who had sort of like crashed and burned already, even though Chris Roberts really liked them. So Melody Maker was sort of giving them a lot of coverage, and I think they didn't want to, you know, look like losers twice. So they were a bit suspicious.
They were an instant love or hate them band, really, you know, and some people instantly got them, and most people instantly hated them. But I think Philip being a good PR was selective for who he got to meet the band, and Stephen Wells met them dead early for an interview for a pub in Fulham, the Fulham Broadway, I think the group, I'm not sure what that pub is, and came back and said to Philip, that's the most intelligent band I've ever interviewed. So you kind of knew you were on the right track with people, and you could put them in front of people and they would make a difference. You know, then James Brown went to Arden with them early for a little Irish tour right before the album came out. And I remember sitting in the pub with him, being kind of the PR representative for Philip, and they just argued with James, basically, saying, you think we're a shit band, but you're a shit writer. look at your stuff compared to Good Rice. Don't call us a shit band. What are you doing? And it was like an argument. And I was like thinking, oh shit, you know, should I say something? Or, and after James Brown, of course he loved it. So that was fucking brilliant.
I think after a lot of those interviews, we felt as if we'd lost the battle a lot of the times, didn't we?
I thought in convincing people to actually genuinely like our music, yes. But in terms of thinking we've laid a seed that, you know, one day will bloom.
Yeah, we were a good concept.
Yes.
Yeah, which is, I remember being quite upset a lot of time because I remember just saying, but you know, Swazer obviously doesn't like us musically, and kind of like the Stud Brothers obviously doesn't like us musically, and even Richard be just like, it doesn't matter. I was like, it does fucking matter.
The thing was though, at this time, you know, we kind of like, there'd been Most Like Lentness was sort of in gestation. A lot of songs which we thought could take over the world, that we hadn't recorded them, or no one had heard them, but they were in the back of my head. I remember thinking, we've got these songs which will kind of convince people. And Philip had talked about it heavily because I think he obviously knew Jeff as a press officer. And we kind of loved the idea of Flowered Up, bizarrely, but we did. You know, I thought It's On was just an amazing record. Obviously Saint Etienne, because Bob was in Saint Etienne. But we didn't, you know, deep down, I'm not sure if we thought Heavenly would sign us, because we just seemed so opposite, I guess, to what they were signing, East Village and stuff as well. But we did a gig, I guess the next big gig was at the Rock Garden, Covent Garden, and Jeff came down, and maybe Martin as well?
Yeah, Martin Kelly and Jeff Barrett.
Yeah, and you know, just whether they were that impressed with the music, I don't know, but they certainly talked the talk, and you know, it felt good coming out of there.
Yeah, and it kind of made sense, you know, at that point on Heavenly was the Moonflowers.
Not so sure.
No, but in terms of, it was the Moonflowers, it was East Flowered Up, it was East Village, it was Saint Etienne. You know, it made sense that it was a label that was kind of like, you know, desperate and mad enough to take us on, basically.
Yeah. I mean, it reminded us a bit of Creation in a way, I think. You know, they were so maverick and eclectic.
But much more so.
Even more so, yeah.
We'd heard about them from, I think, Kevin Pierce, who was a friend of ours, a great music writer, and Bob Stanley, who was writing for Melody Maker at the time. And they told us about this band, this punk band from Wales. We'd heard sort of rumours about them and stuff. And they were great letter writers, and they were writing these really passionate letters to Bob and Kevin about their beliefs and what they wanted to do with their band and stuff. And it transpired that Philip Hall had started managing them, and we knew Philip. He was doing the press for the Stone Roses, and he was a great, great press officer. And Philip invited us down to this gig at the Rock Garden, which had been this horrible pay-to-play venue. You know, you never saw good bands there. It wasn't a place where you'd go and see a good band. It was unusual to go to a band there, and it recently been used more as a nightclub. And we got down there, and I reckon there were 20 people in the room, probably less than that. I reckon there were 10 or 15 people watching the band, and it was dark, and they came on, and I just remember like pissing myself laughing, not because they were shit, just because of how much they were burning and they were meaning it. And it was like they were playing in a stadium, but there were like 10 people dotted around this sort of tiny little nightclub. And I remember being stood by this column and just fucking like pissing myself, but just turning to Jeff and going, this band are brilliant. And Jeff said, we can't sign them out, Martin, it's too mad. And I went, that's why we've got to do it. They're brilliant. And Jeff went, you're right, we've got to do this.
I think Heavenly wasn't a strategic objective. They just got it. Jeff just got it straight away when no one else was really getting it. You know, it took some balls and, you know, backbone to say, oh, we're up for this. You know, especially with Jeff's existing roster, it was hard to know where it fit in, really. You know, so it wasn't the case. We had no master plan apart from signing a big deal at some stage. But, you know, it was the right thing to do, and it was just, the indie single was the right route, because we put out New Art Right and Damaged Goods before that, so it was the right route to do a couple of things with Jeff and then see how things built up a little bit.
I don't think that Jeff and I have ever signed a band that caused so much reaction from other people, you know. People thought we were mad. I don't know if I should name names, but I'd definitely get phone calls from people who were saying, why the fuck have you signed that band? You know, people thought we were mental that we'd done this thing. I remember the manager of like Ned's Atomic Dustbin or something going mental about it. And, you know, he thought it was a sort of, it was a source of, you know, it was a big talking point, this band landing on the scene, who were really at odds with everything. And obviously, lyrically, they were making big, bold statements. And I think they got up people's noses, and that was what was brilliant. And I think that was, Jeff and I fed off this, and we were just running around telling everyone we had this brilliant band, you know, and it was very exciting.
I guess it's why we're eternally grateful for Heavenly, because they allowed us, with a bit of a budget, to make Motor and Junk. As much as anything else, we were in this amazing studio in the power plant. Year and our records really sound like we'd always imagined them, especially for James and Sean. It was like, this is what has been in our heads.
The night is young, though, the mood is mellow, and there's music in the air. And I'm off downstairs, but...
Motown Junk for the first time, it was like incredible, because so much energy and vitality being crammed into such a like 2.5 minutes like that. It was, you know, and especially the lyric, I laughed when Lennon got shot, you know, there weren't any bands bold enough to put lyrics like that into a song, you know, and it was, you knew you had something you could really go out and shout about.
On that Motown Junk tour, just people would turn up with an expectation of us to, you know, talk it like we walked it, that kind of thing. But they were turned up with so much prejudice about us that kind of, it was just inevitably getting quite a bad reaction.
Not Motown Junk. Motown Junk 2 was really good.
Some gigs were great.
I was looking at my diary the other day, and the first one in Birmingham was just amazing. When they smashed our van up.
Edge Bastard.
It doesn't make sense already.
Edge Bastard.
It was a brilliant show, but we walked outside and they'd smashed the window pane.
Oh, I can't even remember that.
No, the Motown Junk tour was a lovely tour.
It was a great experience, I give you that.
It was a brilliant tour. You know, it was some of the strongest memories I think I ever had.
I saw him at the Hibernian Club in Fulham, which was the first time I saw him, and they'd obviously had like a bit of a following. And like Jackie and Carrie from Shampoo were there. Who weren't Shampoo at that point, but they just clearly dressed as fans, and they started doing the fanzine. And it was just, other girls, especially girls, who had dressed up to go and see the Manics, and it's like, okay, this is really starting to happen now.
Manic Street Preachers have just erupted onto the scene with Motown Junk, released on the innovating Heavenly label. Manic Street Preachers have a mean line in polemic, and are determined not to become just another band. Snub pressed them to explain themselves.
Youth culture has always been controlled by the same people, selling the same goods, inflated prices, just more creative products all the time. If you're told what youth culture is, it's not much use. You know, everybody knows what they want to do, and then they're told to do something else and they do it. You know, youth is just the ultimate product. We just want to mix like politics and sex. and look brilliant on stage and say brilliant things. We're the most original band, I think, the last 15 years, just because we don't want to do anything that's been done before. You know, we don't want to, what we aspire to is not what any other band wants to aspire to.
We will never write a love song, ever. Full stop.
You Love Us had been a bit of a struggle to record, in all honesty, for Heavenly. Yeah. It hadn't gone, the B-sides were probably better than the A, wouldn't they? You know, mm-hmm. Spectators.
Kind of, yeah.
In retrospect, it sounds good, but you remixed it
twice.
It
was a bit, and it was expensive as well.
Yeah. It was a bit pub rocky compared to Motown John kind of thing. So it was, we were feeling a bit uncertain about the single itself. We knew the song was really good.
Yes.
And years later, Robin Miller, that owned Power Plant Studios, kind of like I'd said to somebody, that's a hit, but not yet, kind of thing. And he was kind of right, so it was cool.
The amazing thing was, on the back of You Love Us, we got a First Enemy cover. So on the back of the, you know, it went in at 62, and that was probably, most of them were given away. But, you know, we were on the cover of The Enemy, which made a massive difference to getting signed. You know, it really helped that it was creating. I remember Simon Dudfield, the review of You Love Us was in The Enemy was that every single person in Britain secretly wants to be in this band, which is just, you know, so insane, but brilliant.
To be honest, the band had always been really straight with us. When we signed them, it was only ever going to be a two-single deal, and they were very straight. They had a clear ambition, and they always said they wanted to be signed to a major label. They wanted a big deal. So it was no surprise when majors started sniffing around, and really quickly you could see A&R guys at their gigs.
I know James in particular felt guilty with the Heavenly thing and all that. I have to say, me and Richie at this point were pretty kind of full on. Let's implement the Stalinist plan and sign to a major. You know, I feel a bit bad about it now, but, you know, it just seemed like this is the next step that we were going to leave. You know, and I think the two determining factors were, one, Columbia was Rob, you know, and we really got on, and two, it was more money than gold discs. And The Clash had been on Columbia and CBS, and we just thought this is perfect symmetry. That was a big thing that The Clash were on there.
It was, yeah. And to be honest, Rob Stringer made a massive impact on us. You know, he knew all about kind of a Sandinista. He wasn't just a Clash fan that would just mention London Calling or White Riot. You know, he knew all the tracks in Sandinista. He's a massive Beach Boys fan and everything. He was just obviously dead into music.
Well, it was the idea, you know, back then doing an 8-album deal sounded a really big, glamorous thing, but that just meant you were stuck with the label. It wasn't great, you know, the shorter the deal, the better the deal, but it sounded great on paper, 8-album deal with Sony. And we signed the deal in the Sony boardroom. The band wanted the suits all round, the businessmen, you know, Paul Russell and Tim Owens standing behind them, thought we had a great PR picture. Obviously, Richie's arms had wrapped in bandages because it was just post-Four Wheel. But again, Philip had a good plan. Having the big press photo in a boardroom with the suits was his idea.
when we'd signed the deal with Sony, we met some producers. So we'd met Andy Taylor from Duran Duran. And it was obviously the morning of the night after of his rock and roll shenanigans. It was just classic, it was brilliant. Duncan Bridgman, who is a Transvision Vamps producer.
All the big names.
Paul Schrader had turned us down, the guy that engineered Stone Roses' album, so he was on our shit list. we tried to get in contact with Bill Price, but we didn't get an answer. And then Steve Brown put his hand up. He actually came to a meeting with us.
Oh, Tony Visconti?
No.
I thought that was... Didn't we ask him first time? Or we tried to...
We might have... I think Richie talked about Tony Visconti.
Yeah, I'm sure he flagged it.
Yeah, no, you're right.
He did.
We didn't meet him.
We didn't meet him. Yeah. But we just immediately struck him off.
There wasn't a queue, put it that way.
No.
Barely anybody ever kind of came... There were only three meetings we had for producers. Yeah. Duncan Bridgman, Annie Taylor and Steve Brown.
Yes.
Steve Brown had produced Love by The Cult. Kind of some Wham stuff, Bad Boys, in particular Wham rap and everything. He'd done some Elton John stuff, I think. Boomtown Rats, he produced.
Balam and the Angel. The big one.
Yeah.
I think for us it was that classic Manic thing of something like Wham, which is gigantic and pop, and then something like She Sells Sanctuary, which we thought was like an amazing crossover rock indie record.
We thought we could get something out of that smash up, didn't we?
Totally.
And he was brilliant when he met him. He was just so effervescent and just like, come on, gang. You know, let's kind of like rebuild the world with rock and roll again kind of thing. He was just really a good motivator.
You know, memories of early producers. We met Andy Taylor from Duran Duran. It was a disaster. I can't remember why. Why I remember. I think they were just arrogant and arsey, and he just didn't like him when he didn't get it straight away. The reason they love Steve Colt is because he produced The Cult, She Sells Sanctuary. And that's what they wanted their record to sound like. It was based upon that one, as far as I know, that one song when they met him. And when he met them, he said, oh, yeah, your music, you want to dance to it, drive to it, and fuck to it. I said, I want to make your album. And of course, they loved that. You know, they loved that cliche, so, you know. And he had that old rock thing, that old English rock thing that they really bought into.
I was working in the States for that period. I'd been out there for a long, long time, and busy. So I'd missed all the NME stuff and the letters and the photographs and the fact that they were, you know, they were backed by the press because they're intelligent and they've got a good argument. So I missed all that, which was a shame. But it was kind of weird because it was meant to be, I think, because, you know, when I was contacted by the record company and said, you know, will you look at this project? I was in America doing slick rock and roll, very, very tight, bland stories, but it was just airbrushed and was the way it was, and the Manics weren't airbrushed at all. The Manics were what you saw. So eventually I was flown over to Heathrow, jumped in a hire car, and drove up north to a gig, and took one look at them. The brief was, this band want to be the biggest rock and roll band in the world. So I thought, oh, this is going to be amazing. So I looked at this complete mess, you know, I thought, and I lived through the punk period where messes were a mess, but there were lots of messes, so it was kind of trendy to be messy. And I had a word with the band afterwards and got back in the car and drove down to Heathrow and got back on a plane and went back to the States. And James, I was really, they were so kind in a way because they did, I kind of brushed them off, I think, in a little way, or I felt like I did now anyway. But James kept in contact with me and started sending me bits and pieces. And eventually I said, well, what you've got to do, if you want to become a band, we've got to make a sequence of singles. That's the way it is these days. And he was questioning me about how that's done and all right, so I said, well, you know, you can't, if you want to make a single, you've got to drive to it, dance to it, and make love to it, blah, 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 and all that. It's got to have certain things. So I said, you've got a good sense of tune, brilliant, and the lyrics, I must say, are very controversial, but we're okay. But for God's sake, don't put fucks in there. You know, don't put a fuck in the middle of the chorus. For God's sake, don't do that. So anyway, James and I were setting up this relationship, and that was good. And he's a very bright boy, and I love him to death, and the rest of the boys. And, so eventually he sent me this. I've written a single. I mean, fantastic. I said, send it over, right? So I was in my apartment, Miami Beach, new set, put it on, and it was Stay Beautiful. I thought, oh yeah, here we go. got to the chorus, why don't you just fuck off? Right, I went, they're taking the piss. They are taking the piss. Right, so anyway, the way I remember it, guys, is that I didn't say much about that at all. I said, let's go and cut this record. It's great. And I did all the right thing. James, what guitars do you want? Let's get that and let's do that. Let's get organized and blah, blah. Anyway, we went in to make the record, and all the way through the chorus, it was, why don't you just fuck off? Right. And I all the way through, right to the final run through when I was mixing, and I just programmed the computer, why don't you just out went the fuck up. So you got a finished record with a swear word in it and blipped out, basically. And I thought, I'll worry about it later. But that's just the way everybody liked it. There was a little guitar lick that went underneath that I pushed up. And that was the beginning of everything, really. And we had a great, we had a relationship. And it was, you know, it wasn't where I was at all at the time.
Yeah, I think, yeah, the idea was that if we did a single with a producer, you know, which eventually was Steve Brown, if we felt as if it worked out, we'd go on and do the album with him, basically.
We were all pretty happy with Stay Beautiful.
Yeah.
You know, it was a good mixture of everything. We had a good time down in the manor. It felt really committed. It felt like an American driving record. Went top 40 second week. Good bit of hype in. But I remember being absolutely overjoyed that it had gone top 40. It just felt... We were on the train back from Sheffield or something, wasn't we?
I'm not going to remember that.
Just a magical moment getting in the top 40. And you're in that record on the radio quite a lot. It got sort of playlisted for the evening session and stuff, which was maybe Joe Wiley and Steve Lamacq at that point, or Mark Goodyear, I can't remember. And it sounded great on the radio. Even at that early on, because we gave a free compact away with a mirror and Rimmel, that I remember Andrew Collins, the Enemy, saying we'd sold out. That's how hardcore. Like, now you can do an advert or, you know, play in front of the Queen and everyone gives you a pat on the back. You couldn't even give a free compact away in 1992 without saying you've been sold out. Insane.
Strange, it's the first and only time this has happened to me, but I think people sat back and listened to Stay Beautiful and just went, this is kind of okay, let's see what happens next. And I think Love Sweet Exile was next off, and I liked the fact it was going to be quite easy to commercialize, to make it radio friendly and all the rest of it, for that period. And so I chose that. I said, we're going to do this next, and this is what we'll do to it, and let's go and practice it and all the rest of it. And they went, yeah, that's good. Yeah, I like that.
Yeah.
We'd released Love, Sweet Exile while we were still recording the album.
Yeah.
And repeat.
And repeat.
Yeah.
Which had gone number 28 or 30.
Yeah. I just remember there's a Melody Maker piece about it at the time saying, we're kind of, it's got a Rob Stringer quoting on the phone saying, what are you doing, making Sergeant Pepper's fucking Lonely Hearts Club? Or something.
So I'm working my way through the singles and then this thing kept on coming up about a double album. And I remember one thing, I think I did say, you know, boys, it's better to just, why? What's the double album? You know, it's better to have good quality, few bits of good quality. But it wasn't my business. It was their decision. It's not my job. If they want a double album and the record company was okay with that, then double album it should be. It caused a great deal of work for me, of course, because I've got a lot more to think about. But I'm glad, you know, we did, because we got to tracks like Condemned to Rock and Roll. And I'm sure, because this is an interview, you're going to ask me what my favourite track is, and that turned out to be one of my favourite tracks. But I got to work on those, which is fantastic, which might not have happened had they just done a 12-track album.
I think Rob bought into their master plan, and if he was going to go with it, let's go with this ambitious plan. Let's do a double album, debut double album. Let's say they team in the record to split up, because I'll be well happy if they do that anyway. So it was a bit of a no-winner. So he bought into it, I think. You know, the whole team kind of bought into the ambition of the scale. There's no point, even though they didn't have 18 good songs probably at the time, that's why there's the cover on there and stuff. It was, and also they've been it so clear in the press, this is what we're going to do. They could have done it any other way, because it was tough enough being taken seriously at the time. To then go back and do a single album wouldn't have washed. So he bought into it.
We stopped touring really, we decamped to Black Barn with Steve Brown. We tried to start recording and we were so knackered, we went on for a week, didn't we?
Yeah.
Which is 2 days there.
Nervous exhaustion.
Richie stayed there.
He stayed on his own, yeah, just cutting up kiwi fruit and just having vodka all the time.
And starting a collage. And Steve Brown did his sort of, you know, even for all his faults, Brownie was a brilliant team leader.
Yeah, he's amazing.
He made you feel really good about yourself.
His motto was kind of like, you know, it's just like, you know, gang, we've got to make a record, and this is the rule. You've got to be able to jump on the missus and fuck to it. You've got to be able to jump on the dance floor and dance to it, and you've got to be able to jump on the bike and go down the motorway to it. That made sense to me.
But Black Barn felt great being there. It was a proper. We always wanted to go to a residential studio, and I think we ended up being there a long time.
Yeah,
8 weeks. 10 weeks?
Longer than
10
that.
Weeks, I think.
Yeah, longer.
I mean, it was cost an absolute fortune by today's standards.
I mean, the brief was clearly there, and CBS or Sony, whatever it was at the time, that was, you know, you're a producer, you're a development producer, go in there and do what you have to do. But, you know, of course they want as broad a market as possible. And the one thing I'm pretty good at is coaching people to tighten right up. And then sonically, I've did years and years of engineering and playing around with bands. So I knew roughly what I was doing in the sound department. So it was just basically tidying up the rough edges and putting them in a slightly different frame. In terms of my brief on the sound from the band, I think the only thing I can remember that we disagreed on is James wanted a real, what I would consider a cheap sounding drum sound. Okay. And because of the stage they were at, I couldn't shoulder that, because the guitars were coming up real slick, and the thing about the Manics is they've got little blemishes all over the place that you can use. You know, James's we didn't have pitch quantizers. James just used to work hard, and if I could see him working hard at vocals, then you knew you get everything out of him. But everybody inputted, of course, but they were the communicators. So Steve, this is, and the one thing I did really respect from the Lyric Boys was that these were not tosh. These lyrics weren't tosh. They'd been properly thought through. And so I didn't just say, oh, don't sing that, sing that. I actually asked permission to change anything. So I didn't just barge in there. I could see that they'd been written. Somebody had put in a lot of work, and I wasn't just about to sort of just blow that out. So again, our little marriage just came together and held itself together, really, and that was it.
So much happened in Black Barn. We were there such a long time. There was periods when we one minute we'd have a single out, we'd be good, did like Motormouth TV, you know, Snake Escaped in the studio. Stephen Dalton came down and did press, remember? We couldn't get Shora from his more from his room because he was playing on the Game Gear. And he said, I want to finish this game of baseball. You know, we were doing lots of stuff, you know, things probably even that.
Me and Richie drove up to kind of like Tower Records, to queue up for Use Your Illusion 1 and 2 kind of thing. So
in the middle
was,
of the night,
in the middle of the night on a Sunday evening. And then the one thing that happened when we was there as well, which was quite seismic, which scared us for a second, was the kind of smell like teen spirit was just breaking. You could feel something was changing a tiny bit, and it was always on in the corner of the room on MTV all the time, and that felt like, wow, this is, we're not part of this. Wouldn't mind being part of it for a change.
It made us feel even more alone. I mean, I don't think people realise how kind of lonely it was to be Manic Street Preachers at that point. There was no kinship with anyone or anything, really.
Dogs to mow.
I think Motley Crue quite liked this, actually. They did like Generation Terms, but it was lonely making it, and we did have an insane amount of kind of ill-advised confidence, but I think we talked ourselves into thinking everything was going to be all right. Re-recording You Love Us, we felt like that could be a hit, didn't we?
Yeah.
You know.
And a little bit when we started recording It Made Me Nothing, that felt as if suddenly we were actually being as good as we imagined we could be, you know. But I think there was Motorcycle Emptiness was in the background, which just made us just feel it, just gave us some kind of inner belief that everything was going to be fine, because that song was everything that we'd been talking about, you know, in a funny kind of way.
Motorcycle is Brownie's crowning moment. That's the one record that couldn't be better, no matter how we'd done it. You know, we might think, oh, we could have been a bit more real on it and done all this and done all that, but I think it's, you know, this is masterpiece.
Really. Yeah, it was better because when Motorcycle Emptiness came from it just dated from a song that was Go Buzz Baby Go,
Behave Yourself Baby.
And Behave Yourself Baby, and he'd seen these songs and demos and he'd said, smash those bits together. Kind of thing, because it's lacking a bridge, or, you know, it's lacking a solo, and he really, you know, pushed us to kind of like to make that song where it was.
Basically. Proper producer.
Certainly not lacking a solo by the end.
It wasn't lacking a solo by the end, no.
But the one we ran into, as I remember it, is that we don't want Motorcycle Emptiness on the album, and I said, well, it's got a lot of potential. This as a tune, it's got a massive potential. We're not really keen on what it stands for anymore, and blah blah blah, and all the rest of it. It was a weak track for them in their heads, in their wonderful heads. So I remember I thought, well, I'm going to mess around with it, and I stayed up one night with an engineer, and I messed with the drum beats and all the rest of it, and how it would actually dance, as I called it, And while I was doing that, James was upstairs having a dream about a guitar riff, this is how I remember it. And he came in the next morning. I said, James, just listen to this for a treatment for Motorcycle Emptiness. He went, looked at me weird, and I played it. He went, yeah, that's all. Listen to this. And he sat down, and I remember he put his feet, a cup of tea, put his feet on there, and started playing down to this beat. And I just went, that's fantastic. And that changed the tune. Of the band. They were much more convinced about the whole thing. I think they worked on it in their heads, and it came out as Motorcycle Emptiness, which I'm very pleased because it performed very well.
The first time I heard Motorcycle Emptiness, you knew they were going to be a massive band. They'd really arrived, you know, with that song particularly for me. That song was reminiscent of a song that they'd recorded for us, which was Spectators of Suicide. It has that epic, melancholy, anthemic feel to it, and I remember when they delivered Spectators of Suicide, and Jeff and I were just going, this track is unbelievable, we love this song, and James was like very dismissive, like, yeah, that's just easy, that's just easy shit, you know, we can do that easy, you know, very dismissive of Jeff and I's love for this brilliant song, and almost to the point where he didn't like how much we liked it.
Motorcycle Emptiness is my favourite Manic song, and that was the sort of promise of what a sort of Horse and Groom, where I couldn't really work out what it was that I really liked about them, but I knew I did. That's the record where it, you know, well, this is it. This is the promise has been delivered here, and it may be sort of stuck in the middle of a double album, but it's like it's clearly an incredible song, and you know, musically and lyrically, I think really got across what they were trying to do.
From what I can remember, we finished Black Bar. Richie had this massive bonfire, so he'd made this amazing collage and all the books he bought and everything. And you remember when he shoved it?
Yeah.
It
was quite purging.
Pretty.
The process.
It was, you know, we had this big bonfire. Felt pretty traumatized to leave there, I did.
Yeah, I didn't want to leave there either.
Thinking that, you know, there's so much sort of work to do. I got a feeling we were on tour-ish while it was being mixed in Whitfield Street.
I can't remember.
We had two studios going on Whitfield Street.
The diorama gig was during Whitfield, wasn't it?
Only because
Tracy Lords went to the studio and did a vocal at Whitfield while we were mixing.
Yeah, you're probably right, because she was at the diorama.
We came to London, we got the backing tracks, and we came to London to finish off the overdubs and then eventually mix. But the race towards the end, this is 18 tracks, okay? And the more, it just complicates the whole thing more. It's hard to explain, but it's not just a case of that. By the time you're doing the end, at the end of an album, in your head, you're working on all of them. You know, you might have that up on the tape machine, but in your head, in the back of your head, you go, I must try and get that done today, and I must get that done today. So it, really, it's, you've got 18 of them, not 12. You've got another, you know, 50%. So anyway, consequently, we ended up at one point, I can't remember, I think it was the top floor of the Whitfield Street we were mixing. And I think the middle floor of Whitfield Street, I was overdubbing Tracy Lords. And the bottom, the big studio, we were recording Damn Dog. This is Damn Dog, take one. So I was running around quite a bit. So we had a lot going on towards the end.
I remember being really hectic.
Yeah.
The mixing thing.
Can't remember.
Because deadline.
Because
it came out in what, February?
Yes.
So it was quite a strict deadline.
You're right, yeah, it was. So we did the diorama gig, that's the gig I'm thinking of. And I think we stayed at Brownie's sometimes.
You did?
Yeah, it was Silly Steve Brown, so I was babysat for his kids one night.
We did Damn Dog while we were mixing, live at Whitfield Street.
Yeah.
We were struggling to fill it up to 26 tracks at this point. You know, the Bomb Squad had remixed Repeat.
Which is probably one of their assistants in reality.
But we were happy to go with that.
Yeah.
And we were trying to do B-sides as well for You Love Us. I think, when would You Love Us would have come out? Just before the album, so January, February?
Yeah.
And we were on tour because we had Top of the Pops.
We got the chart position when we were playing in Leicester, the Montfort Hall.
Yes. David Quantick from The Enemy was on tour with us. And we recorded Top of the Pops. And we watched it when we were on tour,
yeah,
with Quantic, and it was brilliant. The Top of the Pops, James's Bare Chest, Will You Love Us in lipstick.
Yeah,
we look amazing. I do the old Mick Ronson and start with a laugh.
Going to my guitar, fellatio on my guitar.
Yeah, and we got a bubble machine, and then it went straight in at number 16. It's kind of fulfilled a lot. The dreams really of, you know, cover of The Enemy, signed to a major, Top of the Pops. Sounds incredibly simple in this digital world. But that, you know, they were kind of three of them really. Sort of ticked off.
Honest.
think they wanted it to sound clean and pristine. I mean, I had reservations, you know, Spectates of Suicide, the original Heavenly version compared to the album version. It's difficult to compare, really. But, you know, it kind of worked. Motorcycle Emptiness would only have worked that way, really, that big American radio FM vision for them. And I think, remembering, Rob let them do what they wanted to do, really. He trusted them as people. You know, he might have come down and chose the wrong singles, but he did trust them creatively where they wanted to go.
Everyone was consulted. Nobody ever told anybody what to do. It was always a suggested thing. And then people would put their thinking caps on and contribute to that thought, I think. So,
incredibly democratic.
Yeah, democratic. But it's all down to intelligence. I think they are probably the most intelligent band I've worked with. I think that's it. And it's just a pleasure because you can see the old cogs going, you know, when you make a suggestion. And so it makes you question you as well. So it's good. So, you know, I learnt a lot from them, let's put it that way. When you consider that first gig and I'm going, get me back to Miami Beach. You know, I remember that just going, oh, get me out of here. But now I'm so glad that James pursued me and I, you know, eventually picked up the gauntlet. So it's a happy thing. Yeah.
I don't think the reviews of the album were kind of mixed, but the one review sticks in my head was Barbara Ellen saying there was like, you know, Lazarus that flew too close to the sun. Hell, at least they tried, R.P. McMurphy style kind of thing.
Yeah. Didn't really mention a single song.
No, I
didn't. He gave us 10 out of 10. You know, it was 10 out of 10, it was an amazing review.
I remember kind of Stuart Bailey's review of Mark Sankle Emptiness.
It was Danny Kelly.
It was Danny Kelly, was it?
Yeah.
And he compared it to one of the most pristine, distilled teenage moments ever reflected in music.
It was phenomenal. He was editor at the time and yeah. He never really did reviews, if you remember. Yeah. And he gave that single of the week 6 minutes of, like you said,
compared it to a Moonglow song and all yeah. that kind of stuff. You know, it was an amazing review.
And Simon Price reviewing The Melody Maker was okay.
Ish.
Kerrang was a good review.
Yeah.
It wasn't like, you know, we'd hit the middle of Nowheresville, really, you know, with Nirvana coming and everything. It's pretty hard to feel almost out of date before you've even released your debut album, but we did have a feeling. And You Let Us Go in Top 20 for me was a massive, you know, that and getting Top of the Pops, I felt. And that tour, I remember that tour being really good, You Let Us tour.
Yeah, it was a great tour, it was, even I remember that.
Yeah, it's like a stage invasion at Leicester, wasn't it?
It felt as if we got back on track when we released Motorcycle as a single and the video was done in Japan, and suddenly it felt as if we'd actually realised a bit of our ambition again, I think.
At this point, we were just incredibly busy because you had You Love Us Out. The album came out the Brits week. I think it was like in the top five all week or top three, and then the Brits were broadcast and it ended number 13. So I was a bit disappointed.
Yeah.
Then Slash and Burn came out.
Yeah.
Then Motorcycle came out. We went to Japan, and I guess Japan was the moment when we realised we had actually achieved, only in that territory perhaps, but we achieved something that we set out, because we turned up and there was hundreds of fans waiting at the airport. You know, we did 5-6 nights sold out, 2,000 people each night. It was proper. The closest we'll ever have to Beatlemania. It was truly staggering. We'd gone to America first for a disastrous tour. I mean, America was crushing beyond belief. The American label had done nothing but kind of interfere with a record and change running orders and remix this and mess about with that. We weren't in an indie sense horrified by that. It was just becoming a pain in the arse.
No, the night at the Limelight, our showcase gig in America was just disaster upon disaster.
Oh, Blind Melon kept pushing everything back, so we were 3 hours late on stage. I remember going to the toilet, and one of the big promotional things that the record company had done for us were piss trays in the urinals. Manchu Preachers, Generation Terrorist on it. And I remember getting vaguely excited after being really tense after all these things, because somebody said Slash was there. And we were just about to go on stage, and obviously Slash was there to see Blind Melon, because of Axel's connections with Blind Melon. And I remember I was 5 minutes before on the stage, I saw this top hat just going out the door. And just the audience reaction was just one of the worst ever, wasn't it?
We didn't go on till like 2 in the morning.
No.
And it was just
wrong in every way. By this time, for some reason, it wasn't even our decision, but Martin and Philip had said we should get an American manager, which, you know, and we got Billy Joel's manager, Jeff Shock. So we were traveling around America in these absolutely brilliant hotels, really give us a taste for the high life, playing at like 10 people or 20 people, you know, staying in these five-star hotels, flying everywhere.
And the riots had just happened, didn't
they? Yeah, so we got to San Francisco and LA, and it was sort of a week after the riots, and there was curfews everywhere. Can't really think of a good... Then we went back to CBGB's.
Oh, Chicago was good.
Chicago
your brother.
Was good.
That's because your brother was there.
Yeah.
And the fries in the Savoy Hotel in San Francisco were really good.
And you went to a blues club, didn't you, in Chicago?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. So, buddy,
but
buddy
apart
guy?
From the fries
buddy
and the blues club and the hotels, it was a fucking disaster.
It was a tough trip, and it wasn't really what they'd expected it to be like. When they'd played the Limelight in New York, they went on like at 2 in the morning after Blind Melon. And when they came on, why I said to like 50 people in the audience, thanks to Blind Melon to being the biggest pile of shit we've ever seen. And also at that gig in New York, first gig in New York for the label, it said the only good thing New York ever did was kill John Lennon. So it was tough. Tough going to the record company the next day and motivating the team. So it was hard, and I think America was a real letdown with them. We got caught in the LA riots in LA, so that was interesting, you know. So, I mean, but from America, when they were tired and down, and it was shattered their dream, but it was maybe a long time realization that they never really were going to crack America like they dreamed to do. But when we turned up in Japan, when we did the first gig, we went down to the sound check, we could hear like people scream, girls screaming, we're mad. And we honestly thought, getting in the lift, is this, you know, looking over, is this John Bon Jovi doing down, is who else is playing at the venue? And we came out and there were hundreds of kids. Kids had written Four Wheel on their arms in pen, just mad fans who loved them. And it just kind of changed the whole mood entirely.
Yeah. And we arrived in Japan and it was just, we looked behind us, there were so many fans waiting. We literally thought there's a famous band behind us. We went like that, come off the plane, and they were all waiting for us. And
saved.
We'd done 100,000 albums in Japan already without ever even being there of Generation Terrorists. The whole tour was sold out. They gave us a plaque as soon as we arrived. I've still got a little plaque. Yeah. HIP, a tour sold out. You know, and those gigs at Club Cheetah were just phenomenal, weren't they? And you, Pierre, just fell in love with Japan straight away.
Yeah, record company used to give you about £100 PDs a day.
Oh. In Japan, obviously, we did the video for Motorcycle, which was just a masterstroke because... Sounds kind of tawdry, but then you'd get information from Germany saying, you know, Motorcycle's been added to MTV.
Holland.
In Holland and Germany, and we'd be doing gigs over there. And you could feel, like I said, it wasn't going to be 26 million, but it was going to, you know, we were getting gold discs from the UK and Japan and stuff. And it certainly felt we had destroyed most of the bands that we hated. You know, Slow Dive and Ride had given up by this point, so that was an achievement in itself.
Well, my name is Dan as director, but that isn't really the whole story. So we just thought, look, we're here, it's brilliant, we're having a brilliant time. Let's just do some kind of widescreen, the back of a car through Tokyo, the neon light type thing. So we managed to, again, talk, this will never happen nowadays, talk the label into letting us do this. That's also Stringer's commitment and belief. And we've got a brilliant Japanese film crew company. And I remember, you know, I remember looking in the camera at the first shot at the station when all the umbrellas came through, and I wasn't looking in properly, I had the wrong eye, and I said, no, I can't see. He said, try opening that eye, mate. I was like, oh, yeah. That was about it, and asked him to point it in a few directions, but, you know, the director tag is a loose description. But it kind of caught the moment, and they, you know, it was a classic video.
I've said it many times before, you know, we want to be the Pistols, but now we're going to try and be the Clash. A bit of longevity and just try and get to that third album where we would crystallise into something that no one else could be. And, you know, and then we would really know what the truth was. That's just where I felt, you know.
I just remember you seemed pretty happy.
Oh, it was fine. I mean, you know, I guess I was dissatisfied with the outcome, but I don't know, just...
You're dissatisfied with my kind of heavy metal fucking
exactly,
shit.
Yeah. But I mean, then come, you know, second album, I wanted to prove myself so I had something to look, you know, into the future.
I mean, I was always the weakling at this point, physically as much as anything. I was a fucking... They'd sit by me on planes and I'd be wailing and they'd be like, oh, he's got a seat by wire, you know, and I just... My stomach was starting to fucking... Yeah, I just got married, I was trying to get a mortgage, I couldn't even get a mortgage because we didn't have any money.
You had a bit of a mini breakdown halfway across Yorkshire Moors, didn't you?
Yeah.
Just, we started asking for your mum.
Which was a recurring theme. I mean, the, obviously, there's just a, everything we say here today is a massive gap because Richie's not here.
Yeah.
And his perspective and his slant on everything would be totally different. It could be exactly the same, you know. I mean, I remember in San Francisco, he was pretty rough. We were down in Fisherman's Wharf and he was drinking loads and all his scars from the four-wheel and everything, which had happened, and cigarette stubbed out in his hand. You know, he was pretty... First time I thought like the drink was affecting him, making him quite weak. You know, when you have a lot in your system, you know, and you just get pissed really quick. Whereas James was sort of hitting his stride on the drinking front. But, you know, that Stuart Bailey piece in particular, I remember it seemed that Richie was particularly kind of melancholic in the sort of Disney dream is over correlation. That changed when we went to Japan. Like I said, we've always been the kind of band where if people like us, we kind of
become happier.
Hit on half, make us
more. We're just bipolar, that's all we are, you know.
I think Richie struggled with it maybe more than the others in terms of realising that they weren't going to crack America. And, you know, it was a bit of a harder slog around Germany at that stage, doing shitty gigs in really shitty hotels. It was grim. I mean, bizarrely, they love Germany now, the boys. They love touring as much as possible, but at that time, it was a different kind of world. So I think, you know, it took them all a bit of a shock, realising that their initial agenda had to be adapted and compromised in a way to make the next record. And that was hard going into making that next record, even though, to be fair, Rob put the money up and they went to do Gold Against the Soul at Hook End Manor, you know, in a massive studio, and again, were allowed to do what they wanted to do.
There was some failure associated with GT. I actually still felt as if I loved being in a band. I loved being part of a band. I loved, you know, writing music to, you know, these lyrics, especially. You know, I loved the kind of, the absolute kind of like, the kind of unified military presence of what we looked like at that point. So I thought, I just want to carry on with this. And I never really bought into the one album thing, let's face it, kind of thing.
No, that's what
I just, and I just thought, you know, we're just going to get better and better and better. And what's wrong with that? What's the crime in it? What's the crime in, you know, longevity and all that stuff? Medium-sized venues. And kind of like, and I just remember thinking, we're going to be fucking amazing. We're great now, but we're going to be fucking amazing. I always had a sense of optimism. Then Gold Against the Soul happened and I got a bit tired with it, but kind of I still thought we could do it.
So yeah, I think Gold Against the Soul was definitely a reaction against me and Richie talking endless amounts of shit, because it's very musical, it's unbelievably well played, blah-de-blah, a bit boring. But
I just thought we were going to be amazing one day, and we were already better than most bands out there.
That's more me. I still thought.
No, I did though. Even I think like that in my kind of, you know, most optimistic days.
It was only because we'd set the bar so high, really, that it seemed like a failure. I think Richie was kind of slightly troubled at this point. To find a direction. If you look at him visually at this point, slightly confused, French berets, sideburns, Bradley Wiggins sideburns.
Waistcoats.
And we're all pretty confused at this point, but there's a kind of hollowness to it. That, you know, there's a kind of impeccable playability about the record that it's kind of shallow.
And then everything changed with the Holy Bible and we got back on track in a bizarre kind of way.
Oh, God, yeah. The Holy Bible, more than anything, made us feel utterly superior to the opposition. Yeah.
because we have just done every, we had basically become anti everything else, which is probably what we've been looking for, you
including
know?
The former version of ourselves.
Yeah, we'd become anti ourselves, we become anti, you know, it was the height of Britpop, everything. So we were the, what did I call it? I think I had a name for it actually. Anti-social manifesto.
It's looking back at the 90s is quite odd. It's the period in which they started, there was so little going on that they really stood out. And then you had Britpop and Richie disappeared, and then they came out the other end as, like, you know, this absolutely massive selling group that had number one singles. They were obviously something quite different. So it's hard to know where they fit in, because they kind of like bookend the decade in that respect, but they're completely separate to everything else that's going on. What I suppose makes them part of the early 90s was just that they were in such strong opposition to the bands that were doing well. And, you know, they were really exciting. That's the period I like best of in their career, anyway.
I think, really, though, for me, the kind of glory for all the fallibility of Generation Terse is that if you strip everything away, at least 5-6 of those songs have become absolute standards to our set list. And that's pretty remarkable. We just come back from Korea, and you got people going for Nets for Slash and Burn, you know, besides the actual big singles. And, you know, that's got to stay with you. It takes you a long way when five songs that are constantly in your set list are kind of from your debut album, especially when you've done 10 albums and then had loads of it singles like we have.
That's very true, you know. To actually perform some GT songs is just a relief sometimes. You know,
it is.
Because you just know they work and they connect with people in a really strange way. Kids that didn't know if they were indie or metal or rock or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, we actually did find a lot of people out there that were just like us.
And, you know, you just blast through them live. It's like a dumb punk experience with existential lyrics or whatever, but you don't have to feel like that. You just think, oh, we're on stage. We are kind of, we're a rock and roll band again. It's kind of when I miss Richie most, really, that, because there's a genuine, if you look at those gigs we did in Club Cheetah in Japan, it is a band that absolutely having a ball. You know, it's the one time in our lives where we look fucking happy on stage.
Yeah, he was just gloriously pissed and happy, wasn't he?
You know, and, you know, you got this mass adulation from a place you never thought you'd ever get from.